is, we're here where Hamilton Jeet Kune Do trains. We're here with Sifu Lamar Davis. We just finished a two-day seminar. I just thought we'd sit down and ask him a couple questions, some basic ones. We've got some instructors sitting around here, so we'll, if they want to throw in some questions, they could do that too, but I just got a couple of questions that I got written down. So, just wanted to start off asking you some non-martial arts questions.
Okay.
Because some people out there don't know the Lamar Davis that we all know.
Okay.
And we all know that you love to laugh. So, could you tell us what makes you laugh? Like, what movies or comedians make you laugh?
Oh, man. Just about everything makes me laugh. If you really want to, you can find humor almost anywhere in almost anything. There's really a wide variety of comedians that I've always gotten a kick out of. Some of the oldies but goodies like George Carlin and as far as funny movies, I've always loved the old Pink Panther movies with Peter Sellers. Just the humor there I thought was just incredible and just brilliant, the way that they pulled off some of the stunts and just the acting and just really, really some good stuff. The Naked Gun movies with Leslie Nielsen, just, you know, hilarious.
Yes.
Hilarious, good stuff, really good stuff. But I find humor in almost everything. Life's too short to go through it bored and not laughing about things. I try to laugh as much as possible every day. I truly believe that laughter is the best medicine.
Well, that's some great philosophy right there. Okay, so just one last unrelated martial arts question, and then we'll get into it. But outside of martial arts, do you have any hobbies that you like?
Well, I really enjoy designing and building custom equipment for martial arts, which in a way is martial arts related, but you have to have certain skills, which I've acquired over a long period of time, to be able to design and make your ideas come to life and build. I've always enjoyed anything related to nutrition, physical fitness, anything that's designed to improve your physical attributes. I love going to the gym, I love working out, I love researching nutritional information, nutritional supplements. I try to stay on top of everything and keep up with things that help me to be a better martial artist. And of course, everything seems to somehow come back to martial arts. So, outside of martial arts, just working out and just doing things that improve my physical attributes and help me to become a better person.
That's great. I know that you and I have had conversations about nutrition, working out, things like that, best methods,
right.
Some good supplements.
Right.
Yeah, those are always enjoyable conversations. So can you tell me if there was a pivotal moment in your life that you knew you were going to do martial arts, not just for the rest of your life, but as a means to make a living?
Well, early on in life, I developed an interest in martial arts. If I'm remembering this correctly, when I was around 9 years old or so, I remember seeing the TV show The Green Hornet, where Bruce Lee played Kato, and I'm watching this and I'm thinking, wow, that's really interesting. Whatever it is that this little guy is doing, that's what I want to do. That's what I want to be able to do. And of course, at the time, I had no idea that Bruce Lee was actually a real martial artist and had his own martial art. I just knew that I was watching Kato on The Green Hornet, and
right.
Whatever it was that he did, it was some pretty cool stuff. And then, of course, a little bit later on, I actually started training in martial arts, and my thoughts were that until I could find someone that could teach me what I actually wanted to learn, that I should probably train in anything and everything that I possibly could, which led to me researching a wide variety of martial arts and starting to train in as many things as I could possibly find. There was one point in my early life where I was training in about 6 different martial arts at the same time. And a lot of people were saying, isn't it hard to keep all this separate? But for some reason, I had no problem just sort of compartmentalizing everything and keeping it all separate and only doing the art that I was supposed to be doing when I was in a certain school or whatever. But anyway, a little bit later in life, I started thinking about what I might want to do after I finished school. I had the option to go to college if I wanted to, and I started thinking about it, and I thought, well, I really don't see where going to college would greatly benefit me as a martial arts instructor. So I decided, no, I didn't want to go to college. I wanted to put my time into furthering my knowledge of martial arts and trying to figure out as much as I could about how to be an instructor and to find out as much as I could about this art of Jeet Kune Do and how I could learn as much about it as possible so that I could hopefully one day make my living teaching the art of Jeet Kune Do. And at first when I got out of high school, I had to take just a normal job, which I held for about 7 years, and I was just going to work every day doing the 7 to 3:30 thing every day, you know, getting up early in the morning, going to work, and working as a mechanics helper. And I did that for about 7 years, and I went into work one morning, and you know, at the time I was working during the day, teaching martial arts at night, and working as a bouncer in a nightclub on weekends. So left really no free time, no family time. You know, I was always work, work, work. Of course, I was making a lot of money, which was really nice, but all at once it hit me, hey, you know, I've got this dream that I want to be a Jeet Kune Do instructor, and what I'm doing right now is not really helping me at all with that. So maybe it's time to just give this up. So I just walked in one morning, quit, and never looked back. It's been martial arts ever since.
Wow. About what year that was?
That would have been around 1982, 83, in that area.
Wow.
I just made up my mind that that was it, that I just wanted to do martial arts. I had already trained with one of Bruce Lee's original students, Sifu Joseph Cowles, and I was working toward becoming a certified instructor under him. I had already gone so far as to bring Sifu Dan and Asano in for a seminar. So I actually had him in for a seminar in 1980. And then I continued my training with Sifu Joseph Cowles, and I progressed rapidly through the ranks because I picked up the stuff so quick. By I think it was around 1982, I think it was June of 1982 to be exact, I was certified by him as a senior instructor in the Jun Fan Gung Fu material that he had learned from Bruce Lee in Seattle.
Wow. All right. Stay in school, kids. okay. Where did I leave off? Okay. So I know we've talked about this, where these people come up with these things of, okay, if Bruce Lee was alive. Mm-hmm. You and I have talked about how silly that can be sometimes, because
right.
Obviously nobody comes back from the dead. And but let's just play that game for a second. If Bruce Lee was standing here, right now, what would you ask him?
That's really, if you think about it, that's really a hard question to answer because of the true depth of the question. There are so many things that you could think of that you would ask him, yet, you know, if you had to narrow it down to just one thing that you could ask him, what would it be? I think I would have to say, if you made a very careful assessment of what you had done in your life to get to the point where you are with your skill level, what would you say was your, for lack of choice of a better words, what would your secret be to the skill level that you have achieved? How did you get there? What drove you, what motivated you to become the skilled martial artist that you are? I think that's what I would most like to know.
Mm.
And you know, you're always hearing people say, oh, if Bruce Lee were alive today, he would probably be grappling. He would probably be participating or heavily involved in something having to do with the UFC or something like this. I believe that nothing is further from the truth, because Bruce Lee was all about real fighting, the development of real-world self-defense skill, and I don't think he would be that interested in all of this UFC stuff and all of this grappling and rolling around on the floor stuff. I don't think he would really be into that. I think if anything, he would be continuously refining the skills that he had, and I think that he would be of such a skill level that by now, even though he would be fairly old by now, I feel like he would probably still be in prime physical condition and probably be as fast or faster than ever. And even he once said that when I get old and I start to lose my speed, what I lack in speed, I will make up for in sensitivity. And he likened himself to Ip Man, who, you know, was the grandmaster of the Wing Chun system at the time, and Bruce Lee trained with Ip Man and primarily Wong Shun Lung, who was under Ip Man. And he said that he believed that he would be like Ip Man, and what he lacked in physical ability, he would make up for in skill and sensitivity. That would be my take on it.
Fantastic question that you'd be asking Bruce Lee. I mean,
yeah.
Not the one that I wrote. Okay, so going back to your JKD development, during your development, which I'm sure is ongoing.
Yes, always.
Was there anyone that you would turn to for technical questions or advice during your development?
Well, early on, as I said, my training was with Sifu Joseph Cowles, who trained with Bruce Lee for approximately, I think, 2 years in Seattle. He always left the door open for me to call him with any questions that I had. Whenever he came to work with me, he was just an open book. Any questions that I had, he was more than willing to answer. And so first on, it would have been him. Then later on, as I developed further, I got to know other original Bruce Lee students. I started bringing original Bruce Lee students in for seminars. And I think I was probably one of the first people to sponsor as wide a variety of people that I did for seminars at that time. And my thing was, every Bruce Lee student that I ever had the experience of training with, or talking to, or just sitting down with, just to talk Bruce Lee and talk Jeet Kune Do, my big thing was to find out what the essence was of what they as individuals learned from Bruce Lee. In other words, Bruce Lee had a way of looking at his students. He treated his students in a way that were kind of like his guinea pigs, his test rats, if you will, in the laboratory of martial arts. And he would look at this person and he would assess their physical attributes and their physical skills and abilities, and he would look at their strengths, he would look at their weaknesses, and he would find ways to develop their strengths and to make them the best fighter that they could possibly be for what they had available to them at the time based on their physical abilities and physical attributes. And you know, the valuable thing about working with as many Bruce Lee students as I have worked with in my life is that I was able to ask all of them what the essence was of what they got from Bruce Lee, and what did Bruce Lee show them, if anything, that they felt like he may not have shown someone else, or what aspect of their training did they feel that was unique based on what their physical attributes were, what their strengths and weaknesses were, and what they felt like Bruce Lee showed them that was special, you know? And by finding out these things, you get a fuller picture of Bruce Lee's art. I've always said that Jeet Kune Do is like a puzzle, a very large puzzle. And each person that trained with Bruce Lee can give you pieces of that puzzle. Your research gives you more pieces of the puzzle. I've always been the kind of person that I would purchase any kind of instructional material, be it written or instructional videos, anything of this nature, anything that I felt like I could learn from, I was all over it, you know. Most of the money that I've made in my life on martial arts has probably gone right back into martial arts, because I've always tried to research and learn as much as I possibly could. But the important thing that I'm trying to emphasize here is that you should rule out no potential source for learning when it comes to Jeet Kune Do, whether it be written, whether it be a video, whether it be audio. I've even got some audio recordings of some of Bruce Lee's original students where they're talking about things that Bruce Lee covered with them that are, you know, very interesting, very in-depth stuff. So, you know, I would say that every one of Bruce Lee's students has given me something special. And as most of you probably know, I'm certified as a Fuller Senior Instructor by five of Bruce Lee's original students. And I feel like that gives me a very broad view of Bruce Lee's art. The art went through several distinctive stages of development. Some people say three, and they refer to the Seattle period, the Oakland period, and the LA Chinatown period. I like to think of it as more like four, because I like to think of the period in Hong Kong when Bruce Lee was studying the Wing Chun system. I like to think that that was just as important as any other phase of his development, if not even more important. So, you know, I would say every student of Bruce Lee that I've ever worked with has given me something, and I always felt like I could call them anytime I needed to. In fact, most of them said, if you ever want to talk about anything, if you ever have any questions about anything, feel free to give me a call. And I always did, and I always got something out of it.
Nice. Okay. Let me just pre-read this one. Okay, so I know you're just a very positive person. I like to be positive as well, so I don't like to disrespect people, especially when they're trying to do their thing within
sure.
Jeet Kune Do. So
Understood.
I won't ask you to disrespect people, anybody. But just to let everybody know, what are some of the things they should be looking for when they're looking for authentic Jeet Kune Do?
Okay, there are certain things that that you should be aware of. The thing with Jeet Kune Do is that there are so many different versions of Jeet Kune Do out there. There's so many different attitudes about Jeet Kune Do. The thing that you should avoid are people that use the Jeet Kune Do philosophy but display none of the Jeet Kune Do skills, none of the skill sets, none of the actual tools from the curriculum that Bruce Lee set aside for the art of Jung Fong Gung Fu or Jeet Kune Do. There are a lot of frauds out there. You have to be aware of that. There's even one individual out there who claims to have a huge Jeet Kune Do organization. And he actually does these press release things where he actually is the one that writes them and pays to have them put out, you know, and things like this, just to try to boost his image. I'm not going to mention any names. Some of you may know who I'm talking about. But these kind of people should be avoided because they're frauds. They know they're frauds, but they will do anything they can to deceive you, to take your money, and to make you believe that they know what they're doing and they know what they're talking about. Anyone who is really good in Jeet Kune Do will tell you that the Wing Chun structure, the Wing Chun base, is the most important aspect of the art. If someone tells you that you don't need the Wing Chun and that's not important, don't walk but run away from this person because they don't know what they're talking about. Okay? I've had people tell me that you don't need Wing Chun to have Jeet Kune Do. This is not true. Let me say that one more time. This is not true. Without the Wing Chun foundation structure, there's no way that you can end up with a skill set like Bruce Lee had. A lot of people have said that the boxing is the most important aspect of Jeet Kune Do. Actually, based on my research and the things that I've seen, the things I've experienced, the boxing was actually the least important aspect of Bruce Lee's art of Jeet Kune Do. Bruce Lee himself said that he was creating a martial art and it was going to consist primarily of techniques from Wing Chun, boxing, and fencing. Okay? Now, he said that when he finished with this art, which is what came to be known as Jeet Kune Do, that would be, this art would be it. In other words, it was going to be the thing. It was going to be the martial art. Okay, so there you have Bruce Lee himself saying that the Wing Chun, the fencing, and the boxing were the main elements that went in to form Jeet Kune Do. So if someone tells you differently, if someone tries to tell you some of this nonsense, like there's 26 or 27 or 28 different arts that make up Jeet Kune Do, no, not true. You want to be sure that this person has the foundation structure. They should have good knowledge of all the elements of Bruce Lee's art. There are certain guiding principles that this person should know. I could mention a lot of these principles, but sometimes I feel like you're just feeding the trolls when you do that. You know, you're just feeding the frauds. You're giving them the information that they need to try to present themselves as being more legitimate. But there's certain things that you look for, and if you don't see an art that looks like it consists primarily of Wing Chun, boxing, and fencing, and it looks like it's for the street, because that's what Jeet Kune Do is, it was referred to as scientific street fighting. Everything that we do is geared toward real-world self-defense. In other words, if it's not simple, direct, effective, non-classical, very efficient, and can be applied instantly in the street, it's probably not Jeet Kune Do. If anybody would like to come to me, I'm more than happy to show you what real Jeet Kune Do is. I have no problem with that. I travel a lot. If you can attend one of my seminars or one of my training camps that I do, I guarantee you that you get the real thing, and then you'll know exactly what Jeet Kune Do is.
Yeah, we were there last October. It was an amazing training camp. Get ready to sweat. But you're going to learn and get really good at the techniques and drills that they're teaching. Okay, so here's one. Because we always get people emailing, calling us, saying, gee, I'd really like to take classes. What do I need to do? Or, gee, I should get in shape first, or whatever. But just as a message to the average person looking to start training Jeet Kune Do, what would you tell someone that they need to start training Jeet Kune Do?
Okay, first of all, I feel like your attitude is very important. You need to come in with an attitude that nobody gets anything overnight. Everything worth having takes time. If it's worth having, it's worth the time, effort, and money that it takes to get it. Nobody learns anything just right away. There's no such thing as an art that you can learn effective self-defense in like a time period of like 2 weeks or something, like the TMB Academy or something like that. But anyway, there's no way that that you can do something in 2 weeks, or these people that say that you can come in and train for a weekend and get a instructor certificate, there's just no way that this is going to happen. So, you know, you just have to come in with a proper attitude, willing to train hard, and your interest has to be self-defense for the street. It cannot be this ultimate fighting thing, this UFC thing, mixed martial arts. Jeet Kune Do is not, technically, it's not MMA. Okay, it's a very definite system with a very definite curriculum, contrary to what some people have said. So you need to come in with a proper attitude, and you need to be aware that you're coming in to learn real self-defense. What I like to refer to as real world self-defense. That's the term that I like to use, because in today's world, there's a lot of violence going on. All you have to do is look at the newspaper, watch some video clips posted on YouTube or Facebook or something like that. There's violent incidences occurring every day, rapes, murders, this new thing that's going on called the knockout game, where people just randomly walk up to somebody and just hit them. So there's a lot of things that go on, and a lot of people are totally unprepared for this because they don't think it'll ever happen to them. It can happen to anybody. It can happen to you. It can happen anytime. Okay? So when you come to a Jeet Kune Do class, you need to come in with a proper attitude, ready to learn self-defense, and knowing that you're not going to get it overnight, but also knowing that it's well worth your time and effort. Most people that I know that have gotten involved in Jeet Kune Do training, they come in with the attitude that they want to learn Bruce Lee's martial art. Okay? That's fine. But your main thing should be that you want to learn effective self-defense, because that's what Jeet Kune Do is. And if it's taught correctly, such as Todd and my guys here in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, they teach the correct way because they've learned from me. And we call our approach hardcore Jeet Kune Do, because we're very hardcore about teaching the exact techniques, ideas, and principles that Bruce Lee himself developed and taught. But you know, your attitude should be you want self-defense. Okay, you're here for self-defense. You know it's going to take a little bit of time. you're willing to work, you're willing to sweat to get there, and you'll have a good time with it. It's a lot of fun, really intense, and you know, first thing you know, you've learned a lot. You know, it's not going to happen in like 2 weeks training in you know, the basement of somebody's mom's house or something like that. But you know, you're going to learn a lot really, really fast, and you're going to get a lot out of this. So just keep that in mind. If you go to a Jeet Kune Do school, come in with a correct attitude, self-defense, willing to work. A lot of people say, oh, I'm overweight, or oh, I'm out of shape, or I can't do this until blah, blah, blah. Okay? As long as you make excuses, it's never going to happen. You've got to say, okay, I'm going to do this, make up your mind, I'm going to do this, and you go and you do it. Okay? You don't have to be a world-class athlete to get involved in the class. If you need some need to lose some weight, use the class to help you lose some weight. Use the class to motivate you and to help you get motivated to alter your diet and restructure things so that you can lose this weight that you want to lose. So just, I would say, just a good attitude and a willingness to work and an open mind. As Bruce Lee would say, empty your cup. Okay?
That sounds great. I was actually going to get you to elaborate, like, if someone feels like they're out of shape or whatever.
Yeah, don't wait. Just do it.
I always try and
like
tell people.
Like the Nike people say, just do it.
Yeah. Just to not let that stand in your way from doing some physical activity, because that's what it's for. Physical activity is just...
Exactly.
That's all it is. So, when all is said and done, what is the lasting mark you'd like to leave behind on Jeet Kune Do?
I would like to be remembered, be known as someone who spent their life developing their skill, trying to become as skilled and as knowledgeable as possible in Bruce Lee's art. I would like to be remembered as one of the good guys that worked hard to preserve Bruce Lee's art and to pass it to younger generations so that the art could be passed on and on and on in its purest form and never die, okay? A lot of people, they start training in Jeet Kune Do and they just drop out. If you train and continue to train, you find that you learn more and more and more, and the more you learn, the more enjoyable it becomes. The more your physical attributes improve, the better you get, and you find that this is something that you probably would like to do for the rest of your life, okay? If you ever have a discouraged period where you feel like walking away, don't do this, because you can be one of the people that helps to preserve this art. But I would like to be known as someone who worked really hard to preserve the art just as it was developed, practiced, and taught by Bruce Lee. That's what I would like for my legacy to be.
All right, fantastic. Okay, so getting back to today, is there any upcoming projects that you want people to know about that should be something to look for from you?
Yeah, quite a few things coming up. Of course, we're in 2014 now, so in August I'll be going to Los Angeles to shoot a 5-DVD series on Hardcore Jeet Kune Do for Budo International Magazine, and those will be edited and ready for release hopefully a little bit later in the year. Also, I'm in the process of preparing to start doing a series of online lessons for the website Everything Wing Chun. I have several new designs for pieces of equipment that I'm going to be releasing in my Dragon Blast equipment line. Also, as soon as I get done with the beginning level Hardcore Jeet Kune Do 5-DVD set for Budo International, I'll be starting to work on an intermediate level set and then eventually an advanced level set. So all those DVDs are coming. And I find that with every passing year, I learn more and more about Bruce Lee's art, and I'm still researching, I'm still developing. There's people that say that if you do just what Bruce Lee did, that you're stalemating. You're getting stale. You're not gonna progress. You're not gonna learn anymore. I find that nothing could be further from the truth. I stick with the curriculum of Bruce Lee's Jeet Kune Do, and I find that I'm continually growing. Bruce Lee had a saying, running water never grows stale, okay? So I just keep on, as Bruce Lee would say, I just keep on flowing. And everything that I do is usually for martial arts in some way. It is how I make my living, and it is what I put most of my money back into. So, you know, a lot of good stuff coming, working hard, and just can't wait to see these things develop. And I've, of course, every time I do a few things, it opens the door for many more things. So a lot of good stuff coming in the hardcore Jeet Kune Do world.
Awesome. Well, thank you for sitting down and doing this interview with us.
Thank you, Todd.
Awesome. If you guys want more information on Sifu Lamar M. Davis II, this is his full name, go to HamiltonJKD.com. If you guys are in... Sorry, I was thinking HardcoreJKD.com. That's his website. If you're in the Hamilton, Ontario area and you want to either take classes or come to one of this guy's seminars, HamiltonJKD.net. And you can email us there and ask us questions, ask him questions. We all love questions, just like he does.